All set.
All set.
This is Ham Radio Now, episode 316. We are climbing up the charts. And this is going to be called Look. Up, look up in the sky. Sort of a clickbaity title. Look at that CPU. It's 75%, 59%, 60%. It's going all over the place. We're keeping an eye on this Wirecast system because it's been giving us trouble doing things that we've done lots and lots of in the past. So I'm not sure what the problem is here. If it crashes on you out there on Facebook, then we'll just be back. So Look Up in the Sky is a clickbaity title for an episode that has one of those satellite contacts. You probably see these at Hamfest all over the place. The local guys who do satellite communication will drag their equipment out to the parking lot outside the Hamfest if it's indoor, or just somewhere in the flea market or whatever, and make a satellite contact through one of the available ham radio satellites. And that's what happened at the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society Hamfest last weekend on Saturday, the RARS Fest. A couple local guys did actually two contacts, and I recorded one of them, and I've got a recording of the other one that I'll stick in, but not in this show. But in this show, I will stick in one of those contacts, and we'll do that pretty quick in just a minute. I forgot to bring up Chrome, so let me... That's probably going to push us over the edge for CPU.
Well, let's see. It's Windows 7 or 10?
10.
So they say Edge is more friendly for that. I don't know if you can capture that in a Wirecast.
Yeah. And all of the stuff that I had intended to have here in Chrome, that didn't come back. So we'll do it live. Does that sound familiar?
Yep.
we'll do it.
That's how we roll.
Poor old Bill. I'm going to put in my application at Fox. Maybe I can get a spot there. After CNN, after my successful weekend anchor gig at CNN.
Woohoo. Well, look at you.
There we go. That's me and Cindy anchoring the news on CNN. Oh, I'm wearing my RARS shirt here. This is from my era, back when I was president of the club back in the late 90s. I got a new... a new design. So I also need to bring up the file page. It's got this program in it. We'll take a look at what I did was record a pass. They did the demo, and I had two cameras out there. The guy that was coordinating this is John Breyer, KG4AKV. John does a YouTube program called Web Spacecoms at youtube.com/spacecoms1. He calls them videos. I call them shows or programs. John was one of the guys doing this. His friend Tucker McGuire, W4FS, was the guy that was actually doing the operating for the pass that we record. And then I interviewed them. And so this is some editing that I did, getting everybody together and talking about what they did. David, are you okay?
I'm trying to sneeze off camera.
You can sneeze right on camera.
And I went on mute too, because you don't need to hear my sneeze.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm awesome. Hay fever, but it's all good.
Okay. This is Tucker and John doing their thing, and we'll get to that in just a moment. But first, Ham Radio Now, I do this all the time. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy these programs and get something out of them, then, come over to hamradionow.tv, visit the website. You'll see Arvin, sitting at the bottom of the page. Oops. We have another Arvin here. Yep. There's the West Coast version of Arvin. Arvin is bi-coastal, and, if you enjoy the programs, these do cost some money to make and help us out. So things have been going pretty well. So, oops, I caught you. Sorry. Caught you cleaning up the nose.
Sorry about that.
So let's see. Let me see what my Wirecast. Okay, it's 63%. The big problem we had doing this was when I started rolling a video. So things may totally crash on us somewhere in the middle of this video. We will find out. In the meantime, we are going to go to those thrilling days of yesterweek, week from yesterday, Saturday, and the Raleigh Hamfest and the satellite interview.
Who am I talking to?
I'm Tucker, W4FS.
I'm John, KG4AKV.
And you guys just had a successful satellite contact. It didn't start so successful.
Sorry, y'all. No, I was having S9 noise from some outside sources, not whether if it was sure if it was gear or possibly a line noise from whatever. And I'm sure he'll show from some of the more successful successful footage that also we're getting some picket fencing noise. So no clue where that's coming from, but on VHF and UHF in a populated area here with all the lights and who knows how many antennas and whatnots, occasionally you'll
run a few hams in that building talking on the radios.
Sure.
But it also seemed like a timing thing, because then suddenly there were signals and people were hearing you and you made lots and lots of contacts and you were quite the hero.
Yeah, definitely. I noticed I could pick myself up on the downlink really clear once I cleared out of the way of some of the possible sources of QRM. So once that got going, had a good pile up going, I'm sure you'll see in the footage, and was glad to work a few folks and hopefully get some folks interested in working the amateur radio satellites. I just got into it a few months ago, thinking I'll make a few contacts and it might be neat to be able to say I've done it, and it's been a blast.
Everybody knew who you were on the air.
You made a splash,
I guess.
He's very active in satellites.
Yeah, it's kind of a neat community. I found a lot of the people that are really active in AMSAT are willing to help and get you set up. So if anybody's interested in the amateur satellites, go to amsat.org and you can check out all the resources they have to offer, and feel free to reach out to any of the hams you see listed there, or feel free to email me if you look me up on QRZ or anything like that. And if you get set up right and you learn the proper techniques and whatnot, then you'll have a blast with it.
What satellite were you guys using?
Today I was using the FO-29, Fuji Oscar 29. It was put up by the Japanese in 1996, actually. It just celebrated its 20th birthday last year, so it's still ticking, and it's a great satellite. It's got the widest pass band of any of the current. It's the only current MoJ linear transponder that's up right now.
And you are now, for a lot of the audience, you are now speaking Klingon. So passband, MoJ.
Okay, so the passband is essentially any part of the frequency spectrum that's covered on the satellite. So,
which in this satellite is what?
So it's 2 meters uplink. So the uplink is from 145.9 megahertz to 146 megahertz, so 100 kilohertz spread. Then on your downlink, it's 435.8 megahertz to 435.9 megahertz.
And so this is why you don't want to take your Bofeng and get on 148.7.
Exactly.
Because you might not hear anything, but there's stuff going on up there.
Exactly. So.
And it was sideband.
Yes. Also, the linear transponders are used for sideband and CW contacts.
And you said this is one of the last ones that's doing that?
This is currently the only MoJ satellite. So MoJ means your uplink is on 2 meters, and your downlink, where you're listening, is on 70 centimeters. So currently, this is the only MoJ linear transponder that's up right now.
Whereas other ones are up on 70 centimeters, down on 2 meters,
which
right?
Is mode B, such as Oscar 7, AO 7, AO 73, and several more. There's also the EO 88, which was also recently launched in the Middle East. So.
And they're all doing the.
They're
the
all doing
linear
mode. They're all linear transponders. However, they are mode B, which means it is uplink. You're transmitting on 70 centimeters and then receiving on 2 meters.
Is there an advantage one over the other?
Well, the MoJ satellites I find are easier to work, just because the uplink is 2 meters is much less susceptible to interference for from, say, trees. However, because it is VHF, you will have issues with trees, but not nearly as much as you would with the uplink on 432 megahertz.
Okay, what radios were you using?
For my receive radio, I use a Yaesu FT817. It's a, if you don't know, it's a HF, VHF, UHF, all mode, 5-watt transceiver, and I use that as the receive radio. And then for my transmit radio, I use a Yaesu FT290R2, which is an old Yaesu 2-meter all-mode transceiver.
Now, that's the real reason you like Mode J. It's because you got a 2-meter separate transmitter.
Yeah,
and 2 meters only. It's the only way you can go.
Well, yeah, and...
You could go up with the 817 and
use it for receive as well, but...
How much power were you sending the satellite?
Typically, you want to use 5 watts or under. However, today I wanted to make sure folks could hear the downlink pretty strong, and I was using the 290R2 has the optional PA on it, the power amplifier, so it was running 25 watts today, which is more than enough. However, I would recommend if there's a lot of people on the satellite. And all of them are running 25 watts plus, then it gets bogged down and signals drop, and the AGC kicks in. So
only do that if you've got a lot of people counting on you to do it.
Exactly. So at most, you really want to run 5 watts or less. Keep it QRP so you don't ruin the fun for everybody else.
Everybody sideband? Is there a CW, PSK?
There is CW. However, I'd say it's about 10 to 1 CW to sideband operators. There's not a lot of CW activity. Just because a lot of people that have run CW, the ones that run CW are used to the older satellites that required more uplink power to get into it, so they run excessive amounts of power on CW and cause the bird signals to drop, and that kind of gives the CW on satellites a bad name. So it's made it less popular. So CW is fine. Just keep the power way down, and you'll be good to go.
Okay. Any digital? No. PSK31, RDTY.
Some of the satellites that are used for packet, such as I believe it's NO84. I don't work packet satellites. It's more up his alley. Has its primary mission is a PSK31 transponder up there. So you can work PSK31 on the satellites, but that's not my forte. If I gave you information, it'd probably be wrong on that. I don't work with any of the digital packet stuff or any of the PSK satellites.
I can speak to that. NO84 is a Navy Oscar satellite that the guy that created APRS put that up there with
Bob Berninga.
Well, yeah, exactly, with his students. And what it does is it has a 10-meter uplink and then a 70-centimeter FM downlink. So you receive the 70-centimeter downlink on a waterfall, and somebody wrote some custom Java software that you can just click on the signal. So the idea of this is, even though it's FM down, you could have multiple conversations or QSOs happening at the same time.
Back in the day, there was a fair number of satellites that were some HF component, 10 meters to 15 meters, 2 meters, 10 meters. Is there much of that anymore?
No.
Except for
that one.
Yeah, that's Mode K, I believe, it's 15 meters up and 10 meters down, or 10 meters up, 15 meters down. I may have that flip-flop. And a lot of the older satellites back in the day, I guess, 25 years ago or so, that they were more popular, but there's none of those. The only thing that comes close is the AO7, Oscar 7.
Now, that's a real antique, right?
Yeah,
and that's the one that came back to life?
Yeah, it's still ticking. It's like 42 years old, and it's mainly Mode B.
It's 42 years old!
And it's,
that makes me feel young.
It's meant to mostly be Mode B, which is the 70-centimeter transmit and then 2-meter receive. However, it can be flipped into Mode A, which is a 2-meter uplink and then a 10-meter downlink. Most people get a little frustrated when it gets flipped into Mode A because it's a little difficult if you're running portable like me and John were doing, to have a 10-meter antenna alongside a 2-meter antenna. People have done it. It's just not as popular as other mode satellites.
Now, that one lost its batteries
indeed,
a long time ago.
Yeah.
And I guess the reason it went off the air is because the battery shorted and it couldn't get any power from its solar cells because the shorted battery just drained everything. And then the battery short disappeared. The batteries still don't work. right? When it's in darkness,
I thought it was because
when it goes into eclipse into darkness, then it does shut off.
Yeah, and when it comes back up, when it sees some sunlight, is it a random which mode it's going to be on at that point, or does it come back where it left?
I'm not exactly sure. I don't work that satellite too much. I've received it before, but I don't work the mode B satellites that often. Just because in my location I have a ton of trees and whatnot, so sometimes it's difficult to do that, and I've had some issues with the rigs interfering with each other as far as getting feedback and descents from it.
Now, it is, it's not the highly elliptical orbit satellite, right?
No, it's not a HEO. All of these are LEO sats, low Earth orbit sats.
We don't have any highly elliptical anymore.
We don't have any up. However, there's one scheduled to go up, hopefully, in 2018. However, continental U.S. will not be covered in the footprint of it. It will mostly cover Europe and some parts of Brazil. Brazil is probably the closest to us that it will cover, and that's supposed to go up in 2018 at some time.
Now, is that the one that is going to be geostationary?
That's correct.
Okay, is it an IF-1 or something like that?
That's the new Mode B satellite that's also a LEO sat. This one is the ES-HALE-2, I believe is what it is. It's a geostationary sat.
Well, this talk was about a geosynchronous ham radio satellite, HALE-SAT-2, and it is ham radio riding on a cable TV-type communication satellite. But it was going to sit over Europe and the Middle East. It was actually going to be launched by the Qatar Satellite Corporation, so it was for the Middle East. But it would have a footprint, at least for amateur radio, over all of Europe, getting over into Asia and all of Africa, and just this tiny little slice of the Americas and South America, the very eastern part of Brazil, and nothing covering the rest of South America, nothing covering North America at all. So we were going, that's cool, but it doesn't cover the Americas. So we're happy for you guys over in Europe.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's going to sit in a fixed orbit.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, I know that there is a geosynchronous satellite, and it took me a while to get the distinction between geostationary and geosynchronous. There's a geosynchronous satellite that some guys at Virginia Tech are working on.
Yeah,
that's going to be all digital.
This is Ham Radio Now, episode 272 from the ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference. A geosynchronous ham radio satellite for the Americas.
1,000 channels of digital, and it's going to be North and South America. Does that interest you at all?
Yeah, if I had the gear for it, I haven't read about too much.
It's also
going to
be a 5 and dime. You know what 5 and dime is?
5 gigahertz, 10 gigahertz.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
why. So no 2 meters, no 70 centimeters.
Yeah, a lot of the new satellites I see that are being developed by universities and folks doing research are going to be in the microwave range, either 1.2 gig or, like you say, the 5 and 10 gigahertz, yep. Which I'm not set up for, however, I'd like to give it a shot.
Almost nobody
sometime.
Is, but, it, yeah. But it's something that you're watching get started, and you'll do it if you possibly can.
Yeah, that'd be neat to be able to say that I've worked 5 and 10 gigahertz. I know a couple people that are big into 10 gigahertz, even in contesting. So they really enjoy it. So it'd be neat to try out.
You want to do that?
Yeah, I'd love to. It's going to be kind of difficult. It's going to cost a decent amount of money, around $1,000. That satellite is mostly being built for FEMA, for emergency management usage.
And but they won't need it very often for that.
Exactly. So it's going to mostly be benefiting us the majority of the time. But it's a DVB, I believe, some sort of variation of that protocol, which I guess is used for digital video broadcast. And they're building like a $1,000 ground station that you kind of assemble relatively easily.
So $1,000 is kind of average for ham radio stuff. You know, I mean, it's more than a Bofang handy talkie, but it's less than almost any HF rig you can go pick up.
Sure, and if you're really thinking seriously about it and you figure out you like the satellites and you can invest money. I started out with just a Baofeng UV5R for $30 from Amazon and had an Aero 2 antenna was working
this
the
is
FM
the Aero 2 right here.
The FM
without the 2 meter VHF elements attached, just 70 centimeter.
And I started out with that, so that's under $200 to get started. And I figured out, hey, I really this is actually pretty fun. and kind of upgraded to rigs, upgraded to full duplex, which one thing I'd want to make clear is that full duplex is definitely recommended, which means that you can hear yourself on the downlink, so you don't worry about stomping on people or anything like that. So you transmit, and that's what the second radio is for, so you can hear yourself and say, oh, I hear my voice, I am coming through the satellite and coming down, and I'm not stomping all over somebody's QSO.
There's a bunch of satellites that are FM.
There's currently two active FM repeater satellites.
So not a bunch.
There's two.
Exactly two.
There is one that's MoJ, and that's the SO50 Saudi sat that the Saudis put up. And it's MoJ, 2 meters up and 440 down. That's the easiest one to get to, and John did a demo of that a little bit earlier.
WB8RJY, Kilo Golf 4, Alpha Kilo Victor, Raleigh Fest demo.
Kilo Golf 4X, Alpha Golf Victor at the Hamfest from Whiskey Bravo 8, Romeo Juliet Yankee in Lansing, Michigan. Over.
QSL, thanks for my first contact during the demo.
5-9, very strong here in Lansing,
7-3. QSL.
The other one that's up was actually sent up by the Americans and was...
This one, right here on my shirt.
Yep.
This is twice the size of it in reality. It's 6 inches.
It's 6 inches cubed is the size of the actual satellite, and it's a Mode B satellite, which means the 70 centimeter up, 2 meter down, and it was put up by the Americans in AMSAT, and it's AO85, the AMSAT Oscar 85 satellite.
It seemed like there was no shortage of activity on the linear satellite that you talked through and gave the demo.
Oh, no.
But are the FM satellites more popular because anybody with a handy talkie can do a band HD?
That, and also because it's a single channel repeater essentially up in the sky, and it's very easy to get into. On the weekends when everybody's off from work, it can get really hectic and everybody's trying to make QSOs, it becomes a madhouse and a zoo. So that's when the full duplex comes in handy, so you can be as courteous as possible and not stomp on people if you don't have to.
And it can be more difficult to work that satellite because it's busy, in opposition to the linear birds where you can have multiple conversations because there's a whole pass band.
Yeah, 100 kilohertz wide for sideband. That's as big as some HF bands.
Exactly.
How long have you been a ham?
I've been a ham since October 2013.
All right, and then the satellite started?
Satellite started last summer. I got into it.
How?
Well, I'd been wanting to get into to satellites for a while, and as a graduation present, actually, my uncle had known that I wanted to get into satellites and got me an Aero 2 antenna as a high school graduation gift, and I had a Baofeng HT, like I said, and kind of made a few contacts.
What was the first little spark about satellites? Where did you even come across the idea?
Well, I'd been licensed since 2013. I tried all different aspects of the hobby, some I liked, some I didn't. And satellites was one thing that I hadn't tried, and it seemed interesting to be talking through a satellite up in the sky and making contacts through that. It was kind of interesting, so I thought, why not give it a shot or whatever.
Is that your big thing now, or you still do other stuff?
I'm big. I really enjoy HF contesting, as well as DXing on HF. But satellites have taken up a lot of my time now, as far as ham radio time goes. Just because it's something new to me, and it doesn't require a lot of gear, and it's been a lot of fun that you can do a lot of neat stuff with something minimal like that. A lot of people who maybe live in a HOA or something like that and are limited on antennas, you can go out to a park or something like that with that antenna, and you can work people across the country or even in other countries.
Do you like contesting? I know that Field Day gives you bonus points for working satellites.
That's correct.
So they get busy. Is there any other contesting that goes on satellites?
There's no satellite contest, but I think one thing that piqued my interest was on the FM repeaters. It kind of gets wild as far as rapid fire QSOs and stuff like that, which is very similar to contesting. So that piqued my interest. I was like, this is great. This is high rate, rapid fire QSOs and stuff like that. It's like contesting, but on a satellite. So
it requires some skill to make contacts.
Yeah. So it was that. That's one reason why I got into it as well. It's fast paced.
Now, when you're doing the demo, I'm guessing that's a little more frantic than average operating when you're just
when I'm just
contact
at home in the backyard or in a park or something like that. When you have a crowd of 30 people or so, I mean, the pressure's on to kind of perform and make some contacts and hopefully influence some people to get into the amateur radio satellites and maybe look into it.
And you had just about given up. I think you had given up before suddenly the signals were there.
Sorry, y'all.
No, we were hearing it.
Signals were coming in.
Yeah, I was coming in, but I've got wicked noise. The S9 S meter's pegging here. Yeah, I was running into some S9 noise. I saw the S meter pegging. I couldn't hear myself on the on the transponder, and at first I'd wondered, well, maybe I'm just not pointing it right. Well, I was pointing it in the right direction. So there's some local noise from somewhere, and I get a text from a friend of mine who was actually listening, and he said he could hear me. He said, but I wasn't hearing anything. So,
oh, okay.
So the,
got a text.
So
got a text.
Right after you stopped, that happened.
Yeah, right after I stopped and had checked my phone, he was like, "Yeah, I hear you. You're S9 on my end on the downlink." So I knew it was local noise.
So you tried to get on.
And
after
then
that.
Then after it passed over something or whatever source of it, once it hit, say, that direction or something like that, the noise, it disappeared. Something wiggled or. Somebody was smiling on me, and it got into some more rapid fire QSOs.
CQ UFO 29. This is Whiskey 4 Foxtrot Sierra. Whiskey 4 Foxtrot Sierra calling CQ and listening.
Whiskey 5 Papa Fox Golf. Whiskey 5 Papa.
W5 PFD. Good afternoon, Clayton. Doing a demo here at the Raleigh Hamfest in North Carolina. We're in Fox Mike 05 here today.
Okay, Tucker. Good to hear you on from the Hamfest there in Raleigh. We're in Echo Mike 21, which is in East Texas, about 100 miles southeast of Dallas. This is Clayton. Good to hear everyone. Have fun at the Hamfest. W5PFG.
Watch out, Clayton. Thank you for the first contact on the demo. Had a little trouble there in the beginning with some noise issues, but I think we got it sorted now. 73 from Whiskey 4, Foxtrot Sierra.
WB8RJY.
WB8RJY, good afternoon. This is W4FS. We're in grid Fox Mike 05 doing a demo at the Raleigh Hamfest today. QSL.
Okay, greetings to everybody at the Hamfest from sunny Lansing, Michigan. Over.
QSL, there, Jeff, 73, W4FS, QRZ.
Whiskey November 9, Quebec, W4FS, Fox Mike 05.
Whiskey Norway 9, Quebec.
W4FS, QSL 73, W4FS, QRZ.
Yankee Sugar Echo, stroke 7.
KYZ, stroke 7, W4FS, Fox Mike 05 at the Raleigh, North Carolina Hamfest, QSL.
Okay, hello to all the Hamfest
goers
from Mesa, Arizona, Delta Mike 43. Have a good day, 73.
QSL, thanks for Arizona, QRZ, Whiskey 4, Foxtrot Sierra.
Whiskey Bravo 3, Charlie Sierra Yankee, Tucker.
Whiskey Bravo 3, Charlie Sierra Yankee, W4FS, Fox Mike 05.
Roger, Roger, Foxtrot November 10, Lancaster, Pennsylvania, sound great. Hello to everyone at the Hamfest, 73.
73, W4FS, QRZ.
I was going to take responsibility for it because I have jinxed satellite demos at Dayton multiple years. You know, I show up with my camera and nothing worked. And I thought, oh, I've done it again. I was so glad. And you, John, you had a smile on your face so big, I thought your head was going to crack in half.
When you got it?
Yeah.
Oh, it was fun. I was glad. There were so many people, I wanted them to have a good experience.
Yeah.
And it was nice to hear that.
I was glad I could hear myself real well on the downlink and everybody could kind of... It's neat to be able to hear yourself on the downlink to know that you're getting into it. So I'm glad I was able to make that work out.
And so now you're flying with your receiver trying to get yourself tuned in. There's Doppler.
Yeah.
Frequencies are shifting.
So I should probably explain that. So Doppler shift. You'd have your center frequency where you're supposed to where your uplink should be at the time of closest approach, which is when it's the highest elevation in the pass. However, before that, you're going to start about, for this satellite, it's 12 kilohertz high, and as it's moving, it's shifting down. So as you heard the weird sideband sounding like Daffy Duck or something like that, you have to constantly adjust for Doppler to make yourself sound good and tune into the downlink again.
12 kilohertz is a lot. That's four sideband signals side by side.
Plus or minus 12 kilohertz is the Doppler shift for that particular satellite.
Okay, so you have to keep tuning.
Yeah, so I'm sitting there on the 817 just kind of twiddling the knob.
And it was important to find yourself because that's where people were going to be
coming back to you.
Exactly.
And now I heard a variety of strange sounds as it sounded like people were looking for themselves.
Yes, I'm glad that you got that on there. Whistling can be great. It's a great way to find yourself. I typically just say my call sign very, very slow and call CQ until I can tune in on myself. But some people like to give rapid fire whistling and then drift across the pass band, which can be kind of disruptive, especially if they're
so they using, leave their receiver in one place and move their transmitter up and down to find themselves.
Yes, or something like that. And
bad idea, right?
And they have an automated signal, so you hear somebody bloop 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 just drifting right across the passband, which can be disruptive to QSOs, and don't want to do that. So
there's some lids on satellite.
Oh yeah, there's definitely some lids on satellite. Like I said, also the people who run excessive power in excess of some 100 watts or so when it's not needed, and they cause the signals to drop on the cause signals to drop on the transponders and wipe out all the QRP guys that are trying to have a good time and make some contacts.
So a big signal on one frequency takes the whole transponder.
Yeah, so if so it's typically okay if it's not busy and there's say one or two people, but the satellite can only take so much power. So if you've got eight or nine guys and are all running 50 watts plus, then you're going to notice that the little guys, their signals are going to start dropping. AGC kicks in.
So John, how long have you been a ham?
I've been a ham since 1998 when I was 15. I'm 33 now.
That's funny. I was actually born in 1998. So.
And I became a ham when I was 15 back in 1492. What was your initial interest, and when did satellites become big?
My initial interest was through CB radio. I got a CB radio.
Oh, 10-4, good buddy.
Exactly, yeah. So I had a little antenna, a K40, outside my window, and it wasn't doing that great. And my dad said, well, there's ham radio. So I got a book, and I got my license. And a few months later, my dad got his license as well. And I mostly did FM stuff. Like, I built a quarter-wave ground plane and pulled it up into a tree, like, 60 feet up, and talked, 40, 50 miles away, simplex, and I was like, wow, that's amazing. At some point, a few years later, I got an Aero 2 antenna, and I actually got I used my existing dual band HT and another 2-meter radio somebody gave me, I can't remember what it is, ICOM ICO2AT, and I used that to have full duplex operation, and I worked AO27, SO35, UO14.
How did you learn that even existed?
I don't know, honestly. I can't remember.
QST or
I think, even in the book, there's to talk about and the test, you have to learn about satellites a little bit. So I probably knew it through that.
I think there's a couple technician questions or something like, what is the transmit and receive frequencies if it's a MoJ satellite, and you need to know that. So
you do the podcast. Has satellite captured almost all of your ham radio interest, or do you do other stuff?
So, yeah, I have space comms, and mostly I just do satellite. I do talk on the local nets occasionally. I do HF, I have a 40-meter dipole, so I do a little, lately I've been doing JT65, which is kind of fun.
They don't do that on any of the satellites.
No JT65.
Too long of a transmission.
That'd be pretty painful, I think, to have JT, you'd have to be locked right on,
yeah.
Especially.
And I guess no reason, because that's a super weak signal mode, and signals through the satellites are not super weak.
Mm-mm.
Satellite is considered a weak signal mode, but I think
they're weak. But you got line of sight.
But I believe JT65, it would take up a lot of precious pass time, considering passes are 10 to say 20 minutes long.
But it's also real tiny.
It's true. So never know. Maybe somebody will put up in the sky a JT65 satellite someday.
So how'd you get the idea to do the space comms show?
Yeah. So a few years ago.
How'd you get so good at it?
Thank you. A few years ago, a local ham here at the University Club sent out an email saying, hey, the space station is going to be talking to a school. It'll be in range. And I had my Aero antenna, the same one here. I had just gotten it back from my parents' shed like a year ago. And I was like, well, I have some of the gear. So I ran to Radio Shack and got a connector I needed. I ran out there and I put the antenna up and I heard an astronaut talking to a school. And I made a video of that. And I just put it on YouTube, and over about a year, it got, 5,000, 10,000 views. And I was like, wow, people have an interest in this. So I was like, you know, I think I'll try making some more videos. And I did that over the past year. I made a decent amount of videos and got a decent amount of subscribers, and it's been a lot of fun.
And a recent one, maybe the last one, it was another school contact, and it was a French astronaut, and he was going to be speaking French.
All right, so the food actually tastes the same, but there's less taste, actually, so they put a lot of hot sauce on it. So yeah, actually it's really easy, it's kind of relaxing. We do actually a lot of sport because we float most of the time, and so we have to keep our muscles pretty active.
And you got a translator from school?
Yeah, so that was Thomas Pesquet, and that was the astronaut. And I talked to a friend who had studied in France to see if he could translate for me, but he hadn't been speaking it in a long time and was no longer fluent. But he recommended here in Raleigh, there's a French international business school, and there's like 100, 200 French students that are just here hanging out. And my friend that had studied in France had a contact person, so I emailed her, and she forwarded on to all the 200 students. And there was one student who happened to be have a brother who was doing aeronautical engineering, wanted to go to Mars, and the guy that's here, he had been following along with his brother as this French astronaut went up. So he saw the email and he responded back like immediately and was like, I would love to do this, you know. So
now, did he know anything about the ham radio aspect?
No, he had no idea about it.
He just knew there was a French astronaut.
Yeah.
And now he's going to get to hear him.
Bonjour Mélina, ma première sensation, c'était que ça sentait pas très bon, ça sentait un peu renfermé.
Well, actually my first impression was that it didn't smell very good. It actually smelled kind of like feet.
But, yeah. Now, you just didn't talk back.
No. Because they were talking to a school, so you can't.
And you didn't hear the school because it was hundreds of miles from here?
Yeah, so actually it was in Belgium where they speak French, I learned.
Okay, so they're going through a telebridge.
Exactly. They were going through a telebridge station in Maryland, so not too far away.
Talking 2 meters down to Maryland, and then Maryland, the phone line over to Belgium.
Exactly.
Where they speak French.
Exactly.
So you got another show planned?
Another video?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm working on a video.
I call them shows. You can call them whatever you want.
I've got another video planned. It's actually a demo by Paul, N8HM, who's a secretary for AMSAT. I was up in D.C. where he lives, and I recorded him on FO29 also, and also did a video of his setup. He has a really interesting setup. He's got two FT817s, and he's actually got an amplifier, so he can put out up to 30 watts, and he's got a preamp all in his portable setup. So I think he has the ultimate satellite portable setup as far as, you know, doing it handheld. He doesn't have a tracking tripod, which some people might consider even more impressive, but I'm impressed by his setup. So I'm going to be doing a video that shows him talking through a satellite, and I'll be showing some video of the setup at the same time and giving some titles that explain that.
Now, for the folks that are curious about the video technology, you used your phone.
Yeah.
Right. Do you have a camera like these at all, or
I do.
Phone stuff?
I have a digital SLR, a Canon, and I dropped it. And it's not in great shape right now, so I'm using the phones. But
it looks great.
Yeah, yeah.
And you have audio connected to it. It's not the phone's microphone.
Yeah, so I have a lavalier mic I usually put on me. And that French student that did the translating, I had a lavalier taped inside his shirt.
Yeah, so it all sounds good.
Yeah.
But phones make great television cameras, I guess.
Their phones are really good now. The other thing I'll mention with my videos that I think is important is I record the audio from the satellite directly into an audio recorder with an actual cable as opposed to just the microphone.
Yeah.
I recommend that for anybody that's going to record a video.
It doesn't sound like it's coming through an orange juice can.
You get wind noise, all kinds of stuff. If you can record it to an audio recorder and then sync it up with your video, do nothing else in your video editor.
Again, if you don't have a lot of background noise or stuff, that's okay.
Yeah.
But you got a crowd of folks then. Sometimes
cars driving by and things like that.
Yeah.
Wind noise.
Lends an air of here's our excuse. It lends an air of reality. That's the excuse. Pay attention for that. All right. Anything else that I haven't asked that you guys are saying I wish you would ask about this?
I can't think of it. You really covered all the bases on amateur radio satellites. So,
Just get on satellites, have fun.
Yeah, have fun with it. Get the right info, check out amsat.org and have a blast with it.
Yeah, and check out my YouTube channel. Maybe you can link it in the description of
your
video.
Spacecoms.
It's spacecoms1, youtube.com/spacecoms1. and my call sign is KG4AKV, and I believe if you search for that, you might be able to find it.
All right. Congratulations on a super demo.
All right. Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
And let's see if David is still here or if he's hung up yet. I don't see a picture. We may have lost David. He was going to have to go. There he is.
Hi, Gary.
Did I lose you?
No, Microsoft lost you. Remember that update I told you about?
Oh,
about
yeah.
Screen 3, 2, 1, where you're booting your system.
Oh, wonderful.
So, right. I'm almost back, but okay. You can keep me here for another couple seconds.
Did the video, 'cause you got to go, right?
No, I'm actually okay. Did the video finish?
Yes, but you didn't get to see it.
I got to see almost till the end, and it was really interesting.
Okay, cool.
I've actually been kind of following John for a while, hoping that someday at our field day we'll be able to make a satellite connection or two. We actually made one last year. I was sleeping.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. If satellites were a thing among the scouts that you work with.
Yeah, not among the scouts so much. But for our field day activities, we have been in search of, for a number of years now, to make that 100-point bonus.
Yeah, every club hunts for their satellite guy then.
Yeah. And, you know, it's interesting, too, because, okay, let's take a pause here. Let me jump in on the real equipment here.
Okay, so we've got to hang you up here and...
Sorry.
No problem. He'll be back. David will be right back after this word, and I'll do the commercial while we're waiting. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. If you enjoy the program and want to help us out financially a little bit so David can afford a better computer, I haven't sent him any money. I guess I better do that. Arvin's sitting back there, hamradionow.tv. If you enjoy the programs, stop by there and click on Arvin's icon. We got the Patreon, that's a monthly contribution. There's about 53, 54 hams that are sending us something every month. PayPal is an individual contribution. You pick however much you want, one-time deal. And there's a credit card thing, just a plain old credit card. You can do a credit card to Patreon, to PayPal as well. And let's see if I got David back here.
Sorry, I should have asked you, should you call me or should I call you?
Yeah, I did the commercial.
All right, excellent.
Yeah,
so I was saying, yeah, for field day, we've been trying for a number of years to put the magic all together, and someone went out and bought a nice ICOM rig last year, a used one, and honestly, I can't tell you what the number was, but there's a nice base station type icon that's set up for satellite work, and
discontinued radio, but very popular still among the satellite
absolutely. Crowd. And I think at 2:45 a.m. or something like that last year in field day, they finally made the connection, and I was about an hour to sleep.
Okay, so did you say you didn't have to run away real quick?
No, I'm okay for a little while.
Okay, so there's a couple things about that show I wanted to mention. I said somewhere in the middle that you don't use see if anybody catches this. You don't use 148.7.
And so this is why you don't want to take your Bofung and get on 148.7.
Well, that's not even in the 2 meter band. You know, when we're sitting here talking, when I'm doing interviews there, you know, just winging it, sometimes you say things that make no sense. Mm-hmm. And that, I knew I said something wrong about the frequency, but and even after I played it back a few times, I'm going, what? How did I screw that up? I don't think that's in the satellite. But then I realized it's not even in the 2 meter band.
Right.
My point was, you got satellite stuff running from 145.8 to 146.0. And all of our handy talkies, you know, we can, you know, dial up frequencies like that. Sometimes we're looking for a little hidden secret frequency. We want to talk to a buddy. You should understand the band plan, and that's a vulnerable part, because you could be getting into a satellite's uplink, even with your little handy talkie. without knowing it, especially one of those linear translator that's designed for sideband and CW, and you send it an FM signal. You know, they're looking for signals that wide, and you're sending it an FM signal that wide, and you could be messing things up. So pay attention to where you are.
Absolutely.
So the other thing I noticed was that John and Tucker and I all became hams at age 15. So I'm wondering what took you so long.
Yeah, it was the code.
Yeah.
When I was 15, it was the code.
Yeah.
And girls and cars and a lot of other things.
So as somebody mentioned, maybe was it you that talked about the fumes?
Yes, the fumes.
That's what Don Wilbanks, I think, says that. He talks about perfume and gas fumes. And you have frozen solid. It's not my Wirecast crashing. Let's see what's happened to David. But David is gone. Maybe his computer rebooted again. Let's see what happens if I try to call him.
Gosh, I don't even know what that was.
Your voice,
it's the second reboot.
Your voice is... I see. So your computer rebooted again.
Yeah, a second time. I'm not sure. You know, and I wasn't watching any of the background stuff. I was kind of focusing on the Logitech camera. I'm sure there was some message on the screen. Yeah. So yeah, the fumes in Boy Scouts, we talk about the fumes about 14, 15, 16. The boys get the perfume and the exhaust fumes. And in the 60s and 70s, there were other kinds of fumes that we don't talk about.
I do.
And they walk away.
Yeah. Yep.
Sometimes we get it back and sometimes we don't.
There was a, and it's, this is available on one of the, it was a Tapper, banquet from, at Dayton a couple of years ago. And that's, it's up on Ham Radio Now. Steve Bible, Tapper president, did sort of a survey of the crowd as he was warming things up and asked for a show of hands of how many, who got licensed at what ages. And the 14, 15, 16, 17 of the folks in the room was by far the most popular age. Huge number of hams. All of us now in 50s, 60s, some even 70s. But that seems to be a popular age for getting into ham radio.
That's what my son will say someday when he's long into ham radio. He got it when he was 15, and Gwen got hers at 13, and maybe Lila will be 11 or 12. We'll see.
Yay. Let's see. The other thing I wanted to mention was, and I don't know if you've looked, bless you, Gesundheit. That's painful. I don't know if you've done this with your Boy Scouts or even was aware of it. Not everybody's aware of it. And that is that you can actually see satellites, and that's not the the Google that I want. This is not the Google you want. Is this the Google I want? No, that's not. Yeah,
but yeah, we actually do that. So I'll tell you while you're looking up for the Google and stuff. When we go away to summer camp, because, you know, in the middle of Los Angeles where there's, you know, 1,000,000,006 light bulbs on, it's hard to see anything in the night sky. When we go to summer camp up in the mountain or out on the islands of Catalina or wherever we go, often as it gets late into the evening, I will take a bunch of scouts and a couple adult leaders out. Camp Chwaniki is one of my favorites up at Shaver Lake. It's near Sequoia. And they have a great amphitheater with benches. And we'll go after the campfire programs are all gone and there's nobody there. And everybody will lay on their back on the benches and look up at the sky. And I have a one of those green astronomy lasers, and we'll watch for shooting stars and satellites and look at the Milky Way.
Okay. So you're well aware that you can actually see with the naked eye lot of satellites.
About 18 months ago, they had a really well-published ISS pass at like 10 minutes after 7 on a Monday night. And our Boy Scout troop meets Monday from 7 to 8. And so at 10 after 7, it was dark enough and it was bright enough that, you know, we tracked that thing all across the sky in the Southern California area. And that was really, the kids really loved that.
And for those who don't know just exactly how it works, you have to be in local darkness, but just afterwards so that the satellites that are up in their orbits a few hundred miles up are still in sunlight right above you. So, because right. you need the dark sky to be able to see them, but you need them to be reflecting light. And some of them will just wink out as they transition into the eclipse of the Earth. This is a place to go to find them. This is the Heavens Above website, and they will list that stuff. But the easy way is to get this app over here. On it just says get your Android app. I suppose they don't have, you know, if they just say Android, maybe they don't have something for iOS.
iOS, I can't remember the names right now.
Yeah,
but
there's probably others. So that's very cool. I remember long ago, back in the mid to early 90s, the space station was not up there yet, but the shuttles were carrying ham radio, and started with Owen Garriott back in, I think, 1985. So somewhere in the 90s, I set up a recorder. Just a cassette tape recorder that had a Vox on it, plugged that into a receiver, listened on, I think it was 145.8, where they would be making contacts, and just let it sit there and record for a while. And I wasn't around to listen to it live, but when I played it back, I was thrilled, and I played it back for our radio club. These were early days of ham radio in space. And just so excited to hear Owen's voice or whatever astronaut was talking coming straight down from space. And then I've been involved in a couple of four, I think now, of the school contacts, a couple of them with the with Cerex, with the shuttle, and then the ISS. So it is really neat to hear that stuff. You have dug out somebody to do satellites with you at field day, but is that something you're trying to foster your scouts with too?
There has been a trip or two where I've dragged along. I have the elk antenna, and I've dragged along with some full duplex HTs, and we've tried it, but you know, we're so far up and out of the from technology that it's hard to get the good track on the satellites. A lot of that, you need an internet connection so that you know when it's coming up and over.
Yeah.
You
can write that stuff down.
Yes, you could write those things down. And I probably need to work on that, but we've not actually made a successful connection yet, but we're working there.
Are they excited? Because, I mean, Tucker was 19. He was licensed when he was 15. So he's clearly head over heels about this stuff.
About any time I get any radio stuff out, you know, usually we have 25, 30 boys along on any weekend outing. When I do that, usually there's five or six or seven that are interested, and mostly they want to grab the HTs and go run away and play. There's two or three that are really interested in whatever I want to do, and the rest of them want to play cards or roast marshmallows or, you know, tell stories or something like that.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah. Sort of an aftermath of the program we did with Marty and Sterling on, do we need a better entry-level license? A lot of discussion on that. And it still get a lot of hams who just say, no, things are fine the way they are. Everything is fine. In fact, after the Hamfest, went out to dinner with a bunch of guys that helped out with the Hamfest, and there were two of us that were beating on a third, because the third guy was in the everything is fine, the tech test is as hard as it or as easy as it needs to be. It's not hard to do. So why do we need to change it? And I said, because there's no replacement generation. And your comments on the most cogent thing I've ever heard, your comments on, you can get the kids interested in the radios, and then as soon as they're ready to take the next step, you show them, well, the next step is this book, and that's it. They're gone.
Right.
They could.
I actually have a potential solution for that. So one of the way I took it with, you know, my first Elmer or Elmers, because there are a couple, was cram ahead of time, and then cram for a bunch of hours, and then take the exam. And the Aries group I do, we do a number of classes every year, and they do it a little different. They actually walk you through, a lecturer will walk you through all of the questions in the pool and talk through it and say, hey, maybe this one may be harder, or this one may not show up as many times, or this is one that you want to understand and either remember it or you won't. And again, you can, you know, miss seven or eight questions and be fine. And they have about an equal pass to fail ratio. Both of those groups, if you studied ahead of time, they're getting in the 90-95 percentile. We're going to try the second one with our scouts, because I have a bunch of scouts that have asked me. But when you put the book in front of them and tell them to go home and study, you know, they glaze over, like I said.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that this one, where we actually walk through the questions, both of my kids only missed one question on their test when they got did their technician one. And I'm hoping we'll have similar experiences with the scouts. And I know at least a dozen of them will come along and probably have another 8 or 10 adults. So we'll see. I'll report back. I think we're going to do it maybe either end of May or June.
Let's see what happens. But I still think that your idea that if we lowered the threshold so that they got excited about playing, they took a small next step and could take the radios home and play. And then we teach them how to move on. You know, anything on that first step is pure operation, pure how to use these radios a little bit. So they don't get themselves in trouble. And then learn from there. But of course that puts the burden on hams and radio clubs and mentors and Elmers to make those next steps happen. And we do a terrible job of that in most places.
Yeah, some better than others. I'm hoping we're doing okay. I know every once in a while I think to myself about all the folks at Boy Scouts that I've gotten licensed and how much time we spent after that. And we probably could do better, like you said.
Yeah, we could do much, much better. So we finally beat our friend into a submission to realize that, yes, okay, we need to do something. And his suggestion, a compromise, you know, is, whatever license we make, however easy we make it, let's make it a limited term, like the old novice was. When I got licensed, it was a one-year term, non-renewable. And then it became a two-year term, non-renewable, and then it became renewable. So you get that easy entry, but if you don't follow up, your license is going to go away. And, well, I'm not a big fan of that. That's a compromise I think I can swallow.
It'll get them started. And I think that the ones that really it catches for them, they'll take the second test before the year's over. And the other ones probably wouldn't have picked up the HT anyways.
Yeah.
After that.
Yeah. So, I like that idea. And of course, as we mentioned on the program where we talked about the potential entry-level license, you and I and Sterling and Marty get to decide. It's our decision. So whatever you guys want to do, you got to make us happy about it.
There you go.
People don't understand my sense of humor. So I was going to talk about the last show that I did, the Davidless show, CQ on repeaters. Do not call CQ on repeaters.
Yeah, I was in the Facebook room.
Yeah, I'm not going to talk about that now because you got to get going pretty soon here. I do want to mention two other things. One of them I went over with you in the pre-show, and one of them I forgot. So let's see. I lost all the Chrome stuff, all the Chrome stuff that I had set up here. So this is in my watch later list. This is the one down here that I wanted to talk about. I got a request from a ham who was wondering if it would be okay if he played my One Big Knob show. It was really Riley Hollingsworth who did the talk. And he wanted to play it at his radio club, and he wanted to make a production out of it.
Before we get to your questions, as I mentioned, we are very fortunate to have Riley with us again this year.
So he wanted to make a talk out of it at the radio club, and he wanted... I forgot. I can't... this is not an over-the-shoulder. You either see this or you don't. I know. I can make it over the shoulder. I can put it right on top of your face.
You can cut me up because I'm handheld now. Yeah. Probably the best picture.
I'm sure that you have a lot of questions for him.
So, I know that there's always been a great this program is on my ARVN channel, but I think I got links to it someplace. It is a stand-up comedy routine that Riley did back in 2008 or 2007 at an FCC forum at the Dayton Hamvention.
Well, you could have gone to the flea market, but you decided to come to church instead.
And it's been pretty popular.
So I got
what
now.
You're seeing down here, 31 views. This isn't from my show version of it. This is from their radio club.
Just by your sheer numbers, you make the Hamvention one of the most powerful forces in amateur radio, and it shows you.
And like I say, it was a sort of a comedy routine, and I called it One Big Knob.
That erupts from time to time on the most popular HF frequencies can be avoided if we're willing to be flexible. It's an international problem. It's not our jurisdiction problem. You can defuse it.
See if I can find the One Big Knob spot.
Remember the saying from the 60s? What if they gave a war and nobody came? How many of you remember that? We are all ordinary people. We're going to make mistakes.
Might not be able to
turning
find this
turning off
easy.
My gear and it was my switch.
Yeah.
Says, okay, we're going to frequency B. And
okay.
They just stay silent.
Well, anyway, I'll put a link so you can find it. If you haven't watched it, most folks watching the show have watched it. But what they did after they played this at their club meeting was they had a discussion about it.
Well, first, I apologize. I'm not at my best here. I have a cold, and I haven't been at my best for a couple of days. I want to mention in a minute an article written by a friend of mine, but let me just ask you this.
So I'm not sure he's talking actually about the...
On Sideman, CW.
Okay. Anyway, they had a discussion about it at the after they played it, and no one else has done that I know of. And then I looked at this club. There we go. And at their YouTube channel, and it turns out they record a lot of their club programs and put them on YouTube, which is a cool thing to do. A few other clubs do that as well. But they seem to do quite a bit, and they work a little bit harder at it than some others do. It's on a channel called Ray Anderson. It's not listed for their radio club, and it's somewhere in Vienna, Virginia, I think is the location of the club. So I'll put a link to that on the Facebook and on our YouTube channel, and. And if you want to go see some good club meeting programs, looks like they've got some good stuff too. Now,
thinking that some of the last, we have a monthly Aries meeting, and sometimes we have really good topics and sometimes not so much. Sometimes it's just business. But every once in a while, when we have a good speaker, Marty Wall and 6VI does a lot of good technical speaking. A bunch of other guys do too. I think, gosh, I should be recording this. And, saving it and putting it up somewhere.
And in my club, they asked me if I could come record them now and then, and I usually say that I can't because it's out of time. I'm putting all of my time and energy into doing this. Thank you, Ray, for asking about incorporating the One Big Knob, and anybody else wants to do it, you don't have to ask my permission. All of the Ham Radio Now stuff is... Creative Commons available. You can reuse it, edit it, do anything you want with it. It's yours to play with. The only stuff that's not are the talks from the Tapper conference. And technically the reason I don't make those Creative Commons, everybody can do whatever you want, is that I don't own their content. The guys who are doing the presentations own their own content. They're just giving me permission to put it on the web. I'm pretty sure they would say the same thing. Just, feel free to do it. And just between you and me and no one else listening, if you want to grab that stuff and put it up there any place you want, feel free. I think it will be fine. They want their talks out there. So if you can get them out there more, then do that. Okay. So the thing I didn't talk to you about, let me slide this this thing over here in place of your face. Do you recognize this?
I can't see my face.
Oh, am I not sending anything?
Slide it in there. Slide it in there. I can take a look through the Facebook.
Oh, well, that's going to take a while to get there. Maybe I'm not.
I can see it popped up. It's actually, we're actually pretty close. There's not a whole lot of drag.
Oh, okay, cool. Well, this is,
Yeah.
this is the song that I've been talking to you about a little bit. And I'm going to call this the incompatible challenge. Somehow the other day I was just goofing around and my brain latched onto two things. An old Nat King Cole song. What's the name of that song?
Forgettable.
Unforgettable. There we go. And then my brain latched onto the incompatible, unforgettable, incompatible. And so I sat down at lunch and I came up with these lyrics. And what this is going to be is the incompatible challenge. What I want is to get some people to record this. And your kids are, I think, going to do it. Some folks around here, I think, might do it. But let me put this out to everybody out there in hamradionow.tv land. And I'll post the lyrics. This is what I wrote. I'm not going to try to sing it because that would scare everybody away from the program, but I'll just read it for the folks that are on the audio audience. Incompatible, that's what you are. D-Star System Fusion, DMR. Just buy three HTs instead of one so you can talk to everyone. Which mode will it be when you're calling me? If you know the song, you know which way this is going. Incompatible in every way. Trying hard not to sing. Marketing demands, that's how they'll stay. They could write a little software code. Make a radio that's multi-mode. But it seems that's nothing they'd ever do. And you know, that song only had two stanzas. And then most recordings, they just repeat the second stanza. I wrote a third stanza.
There you go.
Incompatible. They drew the line. You're in your walled garden. I'm in mine. I guess we could just go analog. Leave the future in a misty fog. FM's not so bad. It's tried. And it's true. Okay. So, something to note about that is, that's a copyrighted song. You know, somebody owns that. Nat King Cole is gone. Natalie Cole is gone. But somebody still owns that. The U.S. copyright thing is, you know, just pretty horrible in terms of reuse. But I did a little research. Yeah.
Yeah.
I did a little research. And if you're parodying a song, it's in fair use. If you parody anything, it's fair use. No one can tell you not to do it. You might think of Weird Al Yankovic. He parodies lots of songs, but he gets permission to do them. So he works pretty hard at that. This is not a parody because we're not making fun of the song. And I'm not inventing what I'm telling you. I learned it by doing some studying. This is what's called a satire. It is using that song to make fun of something else. There is a fair use case to be made in using something like that for satire. It's not a very strong case. It's not nearly as strong as a parody. It's not as strong as the other stuff that I do where you're commenting or reviewing something and you can use pieces of it. But the areas where this, where you doing this, if you were to record it and, you know, may have somebody play the piano behind you or a guitar or, you know, some other way to make some music. And you got to do all this yourself. Don't steal anything off the web and try to put yourself on it. There's some karaoke out there with the background music. There's instrumentals. Don't use those because those would be violating their copyright. If you're going to do the music, you got to make the music. And put it on your YouTube channel, put it on your YouTube someplace and tell me about it. And here's the deal. If you do that, in terms of fair use, where this sort of works is that one of the questions about fair use is, well, are you taking money out of the pocket of the person that owns the copyright. And this clearly does not do that. There is nobody who would not go buy a Nat King Cole record because you wrote or you recorded my satire, my incompatible version. They're not going to lose any money for that. But if you put it on YouTube, it still may be flagged by one of the robots out there that says, I kind of recognize that song and I don't think you own it. What they will do is monetize that playing of whatever it is. They'll put an ad on it. I'll never see it because I've got YouTube Red, so I don't see any of the ads. But you might. So when you put it on your website, you won't get a strike. You won't get anyone coming down on you. You're not going to get a call from YouTube or Google or the RIAA or MPAA. No one's going to haul you into court. They'll just put an ad on it if they recognize it. I don't think that any of that will get recognized. It's too small potatoes. So as your lawyer, I advise you to do this and tell you that it's okay. So here's the lyrics.
So is that what they do now? They
monetize. They put it. Yeah. I made a video for a radio club before I was doing the Ham Radio Now stuff. I shot one of our field days. This was way back in 1998. And in 1998, there was no YouTube. There was barely an internet that could handle video. I just made a VHS tape that I wanted to play at our club meeting. And I used some library music for half of it. And then the other half, which is stuff that I shot overnight, I used the Eagles song All Night Long. Beautiful song for a field day operation that goes on all night long.
Right.
And I thought, yeah, okay, that's cool. I showed it at the club and everybody thought it was wonderful. No one expects anyone to actually edit sophisticated programs about ham radio in 1998, but I was a video editor. I had all the tools and technology and I knew how to do that stuff back then and still do. So now comes YouTube and my YouTube channel. This one was, I think, KN4AQ, and I've got KN4AQ2, and then I've got Ham Radio Now. And I stuck it up there, and it went for years unchallenged. And then one day I got this notice from YouTube that said, someone noticed that you're using copyrighted music. Don't worry. We're not, the YouTube police are not coming with a battering ram to break down your door. We're just going to stick ads on it. And so there's ads on it today. And from all the people that have watched that since they put the ads on it, I think that the copyright holder, the Eagles or whoever owns their catalog, has probably earned a grand total of about 45 cents. So, yay. There's, for irritating the people that are watching the video, they've earned 45 cents. Well done. I monetized some very early ARVN and Ham Radio Now stuff for a short period of time. And for irritating the people watching the program, I think I made, over the course of a couple of years when I finally went to collect what I've gotten, it was like $29. So I don't monetize anything. That's what Arvin is for. Because you guys do a whole lot better job than YouTube and Google. I'm grateful for the bandwidth. I mean, YouTube is an awesome thing for being able to build a little, you know, baby business on free bandwidth and free distribution. That's awesome. And if I don't monetize it, you'll see ads around it, maybe on the website or whatever, but you won't see ads in the program. And I don't monetize it. I'm happy with what you guys send me. So that is the incompatible challenge. You guys, if you're up to it, if you got the chops, got this talent, or know somebody that does, play the piano, play the guitar, play the kazoo. I don't care. The lyrics will be on Facebook, on YouTube, and on the hamradionow.tv website soon. You know, if you're watching this anywhere but on Facebook Live, they'll be there by the time you see this. If you're on Facebook Live, it's going to be a little while. So take those lyrics, perform the song, put it on your YouTube channel. Tell me where it is. There are no prizes. It's just fame. There's no fortune involved. Because it's the same deal for you and me, David. There's no fortune involved. But there's
It's okay. I'm still showing up every week.
Yeah, it's fame. Yep. That's all I got. Anything there from your end of things? We will talk about the CQ. Do not call CQ on repeaters program sometime.
We'll definitely do that in a different episode. And maybe in that episode, we'll roll back to this one as we're playing those. Because actually, I had a YouTube video taken down. I'll tell you that story later on.
Oh, you can tell it now.
I can tell it now. So 2009, we went on a family trip when the kids were a little smaller. And I after the trip was over, I went through all the digital cameras that we had in back in the old days. You know, 2 megapixel was the, you know, leading edge. And Gwen, who you know as November 6th, Golf Mike Golf, at 5 years old, sat in the back seat on a long drive we took in France and took about 200 pictures all in sequence. And it was just a funny sequence. And so I put it together as a video and I added music on top. And so the Muppets Sesame Street had the Manamana song, right?
Manamana. Manamana.
Yes. Find that song, because that actually started off, that music actually came from a Italian porno movie. That was where that first brought to fame. Anyway, so I put that underneath the video, and I, within 2 weeks, I got a takedown notice saying that, you know, I was using copyright material. Yeah. And like you said, it didn't say that they're sending the YouTube police after me or anything else.
Yeah. That was early days of YouTube though, right?
Well, 2009. So yeah, I guess.
Very early days. I mean, YouTube sort of got started a few years before that. I think I started putting up a few small things in like 2006 or five.
Yeah.
And Amateur Logic started back then, and they were all YouTube. But it was rough. Yeah, they have changed. Early on, they were very Gestapo-like in terms of taking stuff down. And
they were nice about it.
Yeah,
it actually still lives on, and it still lives on in Facebook land. So my videos, you can find the video, the fun with Gwenny girl at 5 years old. She's a lot smaller and a lot. Well, she's still cute, but she was very cute back then too.
So these days they changed their policy on doing that, but it still requires buy-in from the music producer, and there are some that still say no, we're just going to go down, and you do have to be a little careful because if you violate their policies too often and are not contrite about it, kind of like being bad on the air and the FCC coming after you. The first time they come after you, all you got to do is say, I won't do it again. But if you say, screw you, FCC, I'm going to keep on doing what I was doing and you can't do anything about it, then they will at least try to do something about it. So the same thing with the Google. If you do this too many times, then you could lose your privilege to put something up. And for someone like me, that could be pretty bad. Because it would be the end of Ham Radio Now. Well, until I find another way to get stuff out there and distribute it. Right. It will be hard to do. But so I will play what you put on your YouTube channel on here, and we will just cross our fingers and see what happens. No one is going to bust into your house.
Did you find it?
Find what?
You were talking about the ones that everybody else produced. I was talking about the Mana Mana song that I said.
Oh, no, I did not go looking for that.
That's all good.
So, as I was watching... Go ahead.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was watching the Wirecast system as we were playing the video before, and I'm looking at the... let's see. I think I can do this. This is a little weird. A hall of mirrors, but the thing I'm looking at mostly is this thing here where it says system CPU, which right now is saying 41%, and you can see the hall of mirrors because it's showing itself. During the video, it got as high as 90%, and it gets much higher than that, then it's going to crash. And it was all motion and video related, when the images came up that were just static images of websites and stuff, it dropped down into the 60% range. And then when motion came up, it went a bunch higher. I mean, we're sitting here at 42% of the CPU of the computer. So I don't know why playing a little video made a difference. Do I still have it here? Yeah, I'm gonna put it. Excuse me, put it up again, and just see what happens. I know everybody's curious. Well, we jumped up into the 50s right away, and it hasn't even started yet. Yeah, okay. Well, we're in the 50s. If I make it full screen, does that make a difference? Still below 50%. And we're still on Facebook Live, so.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll keep playing with it.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
All right, I need to wrap it up.
Okay. There we go.
Can we close? I'm back. I got Arvin back here.
Yeah, Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. HamRadioNow.tv, Arvin East, Arvin West. Implore you to stop by the website and send some money. If you send enough, eventually I'll send some to David. Woo-hoo. Yeah, because, I mean, you're poor broke ham, right?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah.
But every radio I've ever bought only cost $99.
That was pretty good, wasn't it? Oh, they didn't see that. I played that for you before we got started. That was one of the things Riley said. He said, if you ever hear I'm dead, rush to Gettysburg because you can get some real deals. He's told his wife that none of his radio cost more than $150. So,
that's kind of an ongoing joke at our radio clubs as well.
Yeah. All right. This is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pearce, KN4AQ.
And I am David Goldenberg, Whiskey Zero Delta Hotel Golf.
Over.
And out. I can sit in the chat room and interact back and forth. We were up to like 10 or 11 at one point.
Wow. I didn't mention it, but I thought it was as a result of the CQ episode where at the very beginning I showed connecting to Facebook Live. And I've been getting 2, 3, 4, 5 member requests for the Facebook group a day.
That's great.
Every day since that episode. And I put a little note on there saying, we're glad to have you all, but where did you come from? And so far everybody responding said from someplace else. So,
and that's okay. And actually having the 10 or 11 people in the room, because you announced it earlier on, that probably brings people back for the ones that can come.
Yeah.
All right. Bye-bye.
Recording off.